Okay, last time we sort of completed one version of the prototype for our example that we were going over. And we then took a look at CSS Zen Garden, and we saw the possibilities that exist where you can take one HTML page or one group of HTML pages and format them a whole bunch of different ways simply by changing the CSS. And that's a great thing. And if you put your CSS in an external file, you're not only changing one page, you can change a whole bunch of pages. Alright, so you can have all your pages have the same format. That format is in an external CSS file, and if you want to change it, you change it in one place. I worked for a large retail jewelry store a long time ago. I was a consulting firm that worked on their website, and they would seasonally change their website. So, for example, near Valentine's Day, they would have certain colors. Near Mother's Day, they would have certain colors. Near Father's Day, they would have certain colors. Christmas, certain colors. All the holidays and stuff that were relevant to jewelry stores, they would change the look of their site to sort of match that feel. And they were able to do that because everything was in an external style sheet. So we didn't have to go and change a million different pages. We just changed the one style sheet file and had it. So there's all sorts of reasons why we might want to create, might want to change the styling of a web page. And again, remembering that good development practices are practices that make it easy to make changes to something, putting your CSS in an external file makes it easy to change the CSS because then, you know, you just change it in one spot. If you have extra stuff in your CSS file, for example, maybe on some of my pages I have an aside and some of my pages I don't. Well, it's okay. If the style sheet file's on a page that doesn't have any asides, then that style rule doesn't get implemented on that page. It's no big deal. Likewise with class and those sorts of things. Okay, so this is the example we had last time, where we left off at. And we just barely started to look at making a second page. So, before we go and make our second CSS file, I want to talk about something that we haven't really talked about yet this term. I know it's discussed in the book, but we haven't discussed it. And that is the issue of browser compatibility. All right. What do I mean by browser compatibility?
Compatibility with things like Internet Explorer and
stuff. Exactly. Browser compatibility relates to the ability to view your web page using different browsers. What's a web browser? Well, a web browser is a program that's written that allows you to view web pages. What are some examples of web browsers? We heard of Internet Explorer. What are some other examples of web browsers?
Safari.
Safari is typically used on a Mac. What else? What browser do you use?
Tor.
Pardon me?
I use the Tor Onion browser.
Okay. Tor Onion browser. That's a new one on me.
There's
Google Chrome, there's Firefox, there's a whole bunch of browsers. People tend to think of, well, Internet Explorer, Chrome, and Firefox, but there's also Safari, and there's also ones that, are less common. Now, a browser is a program that allows you to view web pages. So it has a whole code in there to request from a server a web page, get it back, and display it. And so all these things that we mentioned are all different kinds of browsers that exist. They're all programs that are written. And as we know about computer programs, all right, there can be bugs in them. They cannot work right, all right, for whatever reason. You know, right, Internet Explorer and Firefox and Chrome are humans just like the rest of us are. So they're not perfect. So they may do something incorrect. The other issue is that sometimes the standards, like the HTML5 standards, evolves over time. All right? And therefore, they may need to get their browser released to handle some security issue or something like that. And they might not have all the features of HTML5 completed. Well, they have to release it anyhow, even though HTML5 doesn't work completely right in there. So for any number of reasons, two web browsers might display the same web page differently. All right? Web pagers are supposed to understand HTML and CSS perfectly, but we know that this isn't a perfect world, therefore they will not necessarily understand those two things perfectly, which means that your web page could look different in different browsers, which means that you need to test your web page in different browsers. We have an even greater complication now that you're talking about mobile devices that exist, because not only are they different platforms like PC and Mac and things like that, there's mobile devices and tablets versus desktop computers and laptops and all that. So really it's a big challenge. The hope is that standards are used, which they are, and that they're used correctly so that your page will look standard across all the different platforms. But we don't know for sure that that's going to happen. All right? That's the goal. And in many cases, it will happen. But in some cases, it won't. Now, guess what? If your page looks horrible on Internet Explorer or Edge, whose problem is it to fix it? Yeah, it's your problem to fix it. It's the web developers. Now, you can say, hey, I coded this correct. It meets the standards. So what? People are using a browser that has a bug in it? You have to accommodate that. All right? So you can scream that it's not fair and say that there's a bug in the browser and whatever. The bottom line is, you know, the boss isn't going to buy any of that. The boss is going to tell you, look, I don't even understand what you're talking about. I don't really care. Make it work. Now, ideally, and as I was doing this one, ideally, I would have every few minutes as I made a change, I would go and view it in a different browser. All right? That way, as soon as you do something, and if it causes a problem in a different browser, you can... You can identify it quickly and make the corrections. In this case, I went all the way through making the first prototype before I've checked it in anything but Google Chrome, which is probably not a good idea. All right, but I'm going to go back now and check it in other browsers. So let's check it in Internet Explorer. The same in both. So hey, that's good. That's good. Let's test it in Firefox. Hey, that looks good too. Some very subtle differences. Notice that that is blue here, and this is magenta. In other words, Firefox doesn't seem to recognize that we're on this page and we visited it. I'll bet you if we go there and come back, well, no, I didn't. We'd have to decide if that's a big deal or not. All right. Let's see what else. Edge. good in that as well. Now, in a perfect world here in the classroom, I'd also have a Mac, I'd also have a Linux machine. I might have a machine that has older versions of browsers, because remember, it's not sufficient to say I've tested this in Internet Explorer. To really describe our cross-browser testing, we would specify that we tested it in Internet Explorer version such and such. All right, because each version of a browser is different software, so we really should test it across multiple versions. How far back should you go? Well, that's a really good question. There are statistics available online that tell you like what percentage of people use what browser. Sometimes, depending on the kind of site that you have, you can make some conclusions. For example, if you're working on a browser on a website that is dedicated to software developers, you might be able to assume that they have a slightly higher end computer than if you were and more up to date software than if you were working on stuff for just the general public. That being said, here's my philosophy. A page doesn't need to look identical on every browser you view it in, but it shouldn't be broken in any browser. All right. In other words, if I were to run this in a browser and there would be some small issue that didn't really affect the usage, I guess the highlighting of the page that we're on is a small issue, and I'd have to decide if that was important enough to correct or not. All right. So if it doesn't look identical, that's okay, but it ought to look good. It ought to look ideally, it would look good and usable across different platforms. Doesn't have to look identical, though. That's one thing that sometimes web designers obsess about. A lot of web designers have a background in graphic design and have done things like print layout. Now, if you design a magazine, every copy of that magazine is going to look identical, right? In other words, if you and I both go to the bookstore and buy a copy of a magazine, the magazine's the same size for both of us. It's not like you're getting a magazine that's 5x7 and I'm getting one that's 8x10, right? So therefore, the layout is going to look identical because everyone buys the same magazine. Web pages are different, all right, because people may be viewing in different browsers and in different size windows and so on. And therefore, it's important to test all that. And again, it doesn't have to look identical, but it has to be workable, all right? Now, this has always been an issue with web development, but nowadays, with mobile devices being so popular, this is like an issue times 10, all right? Because the mobile world with tablets and phones and all sorts of things like that, gaming consoles that you can browse the web on, all these things just make it more difficult. There is a simulator built right within Google Chrome that I can go in and say, no, this is not Google. There is a simulator built within Google Chrome where I can say, show me what this page looks like on an iPhone 6. That shows me what the page looks like. Or a Galaxy S5. So we can get an idea without having to have a million different phones what it's going to look like on certain mobile devices. Now, I already see some issues. These links on an iPhone 5, those links are going to be very tiny. All right. We will cover probably sometime next week If not, the week after. Oh, no, we're not going to be doing anything next week. All right, next week's spring break. All right. But the next week of classes, we may be talking about mobile stuff specifically. So we're just going to not worry about that right now. We'll deal with the issue of mobile devices when we return after spring break, either that week or the week after that. But it's your responsibility as a web developer to test across all these platforms, I guess is what I'm saying. All right. It doesn't matter whose fault it is. It doesn't matter if there's a bug in Internet Explorer or Google Chrome or whatever. It's your web page. Eh? You got to make it work. All right. There's all kinds of things that people call hacks or workarounds that you can employ that will increase the browser compatibility of your site. All right. So onward and upward. What I want to do now is I want to come up with a second layout. All right. And I'm going to write a little on the board before I do this. As far as the layout goes on a web page, either you control it or the browser controls it. Okay? That's the way that anything works on web pages as far as the appearance and layout goes. By you controlling it, I mean you control it via the CSS. So your two choices are CSS to control the layout or browser defaults. As far as browser defaults go, that is called the flow model. Not Flow, the woman from Progressive Insurance. She didn't create this, but flow. And that's the default that we've seen in all our examples, even the last one. The last example used the flow. In other words, we used CSS in that last example, but we didn't use any CSS that affected the layout. We used CSS that affected the size of things, and we put borders on things and margins and padding and all that. So we affected a little bit, but we didn't really affect the overall layout. The flow layout simply says stuff gets stacked on top of each other. Blocks get stacked on top of each other. And that's what the browser is going to do by default. And that's what the browser did in our case. Our header, nav, content section, and footer just get stacked, just flows, first, second, third, fourth. So that's the browser default. With CSS, we have three basic options. We have, and we're gonna talk about two of the options. But there's really going to be one, what did I say, there's three options, right? We're going to talk about all three of them. Two of them we're going to talk about a little bit, because they're important for you to know, just in case you see an example, or in some cases they have value, etc. But really the third one is the one that we're going to focus on, all right? There's a fixed layout, which is absolute positioning. There's relative positioning. And finally, there's floating. All right. So we're going to study CSS to do all this stuff. Now, first what we're going to talk about is called absolute positioning. And absolute positioning is where we nail something down in a specific spot on the page. Usually based on the top left corner. So, I have a web page that corner is 0 pixels from the top, 0 pixels from the left. All right? I want to welcome to our class R2-D2. Attitude is where I will say that I will put my heading 10 pixels from the left, 10 pixels from the top. Or 10 pixels from the top, 10 pixels from the left. I'm going to put my navigation 100 pixels from the top, 10 pixels from the left. I'm going to put my content maybe 100 pixels from the top and 100 pixels from the left. And finally, I'm going to put my footer pixels from the top and 10 pixels from the left. This is sometimes called a frozen layout, or a fixed, or sometimes they say it's like ice, because it doesn't move. So if I resize this window, none of these move position and none of these change size. Alright? Which can be a problem, especially as we start talking about people with different size monitors and people with mobile devices versus desktop devices and so on. This is kind of the way that a lot of layouts were done in going back. And it still has its place. Some of the designs on CSS Zen Garden that are very intricate, my guess would be that they used a fixed layout for those because they absolutely want to nail down things in certain positions. So we're going to go over this. Pretty straightforward. All right? And we're going to go over it to make our page look like this. There are two other things I want to mention. There's a fourth thing called fixed that we'll talk about, all right, at some point. Now, so that's another thing that we're going to get to at some point. Now, here's sort of a catch. You can mix and match CSS control and the flow. Usually that's not going to work out very good. Alright? There's a couple cases where it will, but a lot of times, and I'll give you a for instance. If I were to put a style line here that says 10 pixels, and I didn't put any position on this, it's going to put it in the flow, which means it's going to put it on the top of the page, so it would overlap with the header, all right, if I didn't put a position. So if I don't put a position, it goes with the flow. By giving it a position, that takes it out of the flow. So it's not considered a factor with the flow, so the flow positioning will again start at the very top of the page, and you'll get some things overlapping. And we'll see an example of that. All right. So what I want to do today is I want to redo our first prototype, but I want to do it in this model where I'm assigning fixed positions to these things. Again, why would you create two different prototypes? Well, two different prototypes give you the ability to show to a customer. We can do it this way, we can do it that way, right? Remember I said that when you develop a prototype, in a way it's good to have a thick skin because you're liable to get feedback, you're liable to get criticism for it, all right? And don't take the criticism personally, because what you want to know is you want to know how to develop the website best for your customers. And if they give you feedback like that, that's going to improve your design. So you can sort of anticipate that and give them options to choose from. All right? It's very hard sometimes when you give someone a blank slate to say, you know, draw what you want your web page to look like, or draw what your ideal living room would look like. All right? It's real hard when you start with a blank slate. But you know what? If someone showed me two alternatives, just about everyone can say, oh, I like that one better than that one. All right? So it's good to provide alternatives because that sort of helps people get a sense of what's possible and maybe come to better conclusions than if you just gave them a blank slate and say, draw your website. So let's go and let's make our second prototype look like the fixed layout. So I'm going to go and go into prototype 2. I'm going to open my CSS. And I'm going to put my header for the header position absolute, top 10 pixels left 10 pixels. Save it, and I'm going to view it. Now, before we view it, I only put a position on one thing, right? I put the header to be in a certain position, 10 pixels from the top of the page, 10 pixels from the left. So it's going to be in the window about here. I didn't put anything in those other components of the page. So what are they going to be? They're going to be in the flow, starting at the top of the page. So in other words, there's going to be an overlap between the navigation and the content area, probably, and the header. So let's go in and look at that. And just as I said, that is positioned 10 pixels from the top, 10 pixels from the left. The other three things go in the flow. All right? Which means, because I didn't put any position on those, so the browser takes control. The browser takes the wheel, all right? And the way the browser does layout is it does it using the flow model, which says just start stacking things up from the top of the page going down. So obviously, here's a case where we wouldn't want to mix positioning in our CSS and letting the browser do it. There's only a handful of times when that works out good. All right, that's a little spoiler alert for you. All right. Only a handful of times when that works good. And this certainly isn't one of them. So what am I going to do? I'm going to go in and add positions to those other things and try to make it work. All righty. So I'm actually just going to guess at some of these things. The nav is now going to be oriented vertically. So I'm going to say top maybe 200 pixels and left maybe also 10 pixels. And I'm going to keep list style type of none. I'm not going to have list li. I'm going to get rid of this style rule. I'm going to get rid of this style rule. One of the things I didn't like about my first prototype is that the links were awful small. And to do that, we had to make the links kind of small. And I didn't really like that. So maybe we can fix that by making our links stacked vertically. So let's see what we have. Now remember, I've given a style to the nav, or I've given a position to the nav, so it's going to fall in place somewhere over here. These other two things are going to simply push up a little bit because I haven't given a position for those. So they're going to be in the flow. All right. And as predicted, that's sort of what happens, except I made a mistake. I forgot to say position absolute. So that's why it's still in the flow. Now it's going to look the way I described. All right, so it's there. I can actually bump it up a little bit. So maybe I will say top 160. A little too high, 140. All right, there we go. Now those other two, of course, they don't have a position yet, so therefore they're in the flow. So I'm going to go and I'm going to put a position for the other two things on my page. So I'll copy that on section. Do that on this. And this will be a top 140, and it'll be left, make it 220. Now I am then going to make this width of 570, because it's no longer do we want it to go all the way across the page, because we have the navigation next to it. And then I will give this guy a top of, let's try 440. All right, not bad. I could probably wiggle this a little bit. Let's give this a width of 240, and let's make the top of this one 340. Now notice how, as we make this smaller, stuff gets cut off, doesn't move. We've defined certain absolute sizes. If we viewed this on a gigantic monitor, this would look like a postage stamp in the corner of the window. If we were to view this on a mobile device, get to that now. But we see it doesn't look particularly good in a mobile device. Now there's a few drawbacks with this, namely with the height. I don't know how big the height is going to be of that section, so I could put a height inside there. So maybe I put a height of 400. And then I made the top of this 580. going to spend tons of time on this because this is a very specialized, you know, this is only going to be used under certain circumstances. But now imagine how much better your presentation would be to go in and say, you know, I've developed for you a couple of prototypes of what I think your site is going to look like. Here's one option. Here's another option. And you can look and make it, you can discuss and say what you like about one, what you don't like about the other, and so on. And again, you would want to explain to them, you know, show this on different size windows and on different browsers and on mobile devices and so forth. All right? Questions on that?
So why did you take out the margin?
Well, because I'm nailing it down to a certain spot on the screen. And if I want to, and if I want it pushed over 10 from the other one, I'll just change the left to be 10 further.
You know what I mean? The margin would stack.
That's a good question. Let's go and put a margin.
Or the two replace each other, I guess. What you're saying.
In a way, if I'm nailing it down to a specific spot on the screen, for me, a margin just confuses the issue. So if I were to say margin 10 pixel, it pushed it down, but that would be effective. That would be pretty much the same as saying top 20, left 20. So rather than giving me two things to worry about, I'm going to worry about one thing. All right, so this is an absolute positioning. Absolute positioning is where you specify a top and a left. You can also specify a bottom and a right, but usually it works better with top and left. Next thing that we're going to do is we're going to use what's called relative. Now, and we're going to talk about how, we're going to talk about another way to achieve the same look as this. That might be a little bit easier. Maybe. I just lost my train of thought.
Positioning from example two, and we'll see what we have. All right? Because when I remove all the positioning from example two, we're going to have this. Which is close to what we want. What's the difference between this and what we want? Well, we're going to move this guy up here. We want to move this guy up. And we can use relative positioning to do that. So let's go in, let's look at that second example, and tweak it a bit. So we're going to get rid of all positioning again. I'm going to start with a blank slate. So now we look at this, and
displays on.
You're going to have to guess what it looks like based on code that you didn't see. Okay, let me show you the code. Let me show you what I did. I just took out everything about positioning. So, the header, no positioning. The navigation, no positioning. The main section, no positioning. And the footer, no positioning. So it has the sizes that it had in the other example, but it doesn't have any of the positioning. So if we go and look at this, now I open it up, it's just as predicted. It's stuff stacked on stuff. Now here's where I could put some margins back in, because it makes sense, because I'm using the flow. All right, I'm just letting it flow, and I could say, well, let's see here. This guy, I want to have a margin in all four directions of 10 pixels. And same with all these other things. So now there's going to be kind of the same thing that we had before, except there is going to be a space between stuff. Alright, so a little gap between there. Alright, now all I have to do is figure out how to push this guy this much here, this direction, and up. So I have to push this guy over to the right and up. Where am I pushing it from? I'm pushing it from where the browser wants to display it. So when I use relative positioning, is relative to what? Is relative to where the browser was going to place it within the flow. So, I'm going to say left. And I'm going to guess 260 pixels. So I want to push it 260 pixels from the left to the right. Now, I want to push it up. So from the top to the bottom, if I were to give a positive number, it would push it down further. I want to push this up, so I give a negative number. So top, negative, let's make 200 pixels. And I have to specify the position is relative. So now I look at this, and that's what I get, which is close, but no cigar. I can fiddle with it. Okay, getting warmer. Give these things heights and all that to make the calculation better. I do wrong. Top 190, what does that mean?
Pushing
from the top down 190. So I want to make that what? Negative 190. And there you go. Now, this essentially is the same layout as the second one that we had, right? But, in a way, this seems a little simpler. There's less stuff that we had to fiddle with. Alright? And if we were to make the header bigger, things would adjust themselves and so on. Yes?
Can you explain again why you have to do the negative? Like, what are you going off of when you put the negative 190?
Alright. If I were to put a 100, positive 100, it would push it 100 pixels down. If I say negative 100, it will push it 100 pixels up. So let's see, without that in there at all right, so I'm getting rid of that position on the footer. And if I look at it, the footer's too low, right? Because it's figuring out the flow, all right? It figured out that's where, if it was using the flow, the browser was using the flow, that's where it would want to put it. So I want to change that. How do I want to change it? I want to push it up a certain number of pixels. Well, what does up mean? Up means a negative value for the top. This is a pretty simple way to achieve this pretty much the same layout we did with the absolute, with just a little less fiddling. Yes?
When you do relative, when you move left and right, does it adjust, or is it like kind of like absolute, or it kind of stays stuck? Like if you were like on a wider monitor?
If you're on a wider monitor, yeah, it's going to stay stuck.
Okay.
What makes it stay stuck is the value that we gave the value in pixels. That's a certain number of pixels that is, boom, that's hardwired in there. So, I don't know, this is an okay way to do a layout. This is still a little bit vulnerable, though, because if I make things, if I add links to it, that's going to push stuff down, and that may mess things up. All right, so I'm still not real happy with this. Next time, we're going to cover the last two. Fixed position is kind of fun, and it's actually pretty easy to do. All right. The last one that we're going to cover is floating, and we're going to spend a lot of time on that because that is a little bit tricky. All right. We will see you in lab.